إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. My respected brothers and sisters, today I'm going to talk about a very important subject, and that is raising our family the Islamic way. You know, our family is the most important thing in our life, the most important asset of our life, the most important investment of our life, because family is something which can make our this dunya Jannah and the life hereafter Jannah. My brothers and my sisters, our family is the one we love the most, we care the most, and this is the most important subject of our life. So today, inshallah, I'm going to talk about the tarbiyah, how to raise our family, my brothers and my sisters. The very first thing I would say is to have the right perspective of life. Why you are doing what you are doing. And before I go in the right perspective, I want to share with you the saying of Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Hazrat Ali says that don't raise your kids the way you were raised, because your kids are born for a different generation. And their generation has its own needs, its own requirements, its own challenges. So try to equip your children to face the challenges of their generation, their time, their age, my brothers and my sisters. And also we have to understand, raising family is a skill. It's a challenge. It's not like old days when family was raised by so many people around them, especially people who are living in West. This is my responsibility, my job. It's more on my shoulder now. So it's really, it's becoming a skill that we all learn, no matter how senior we are, no matter how many kids we have, no matter in what age group we are, we all learn every day for this skill, my brothers and my sisters. Having the right vision, having the right perspective, setting the right goal, setting the right priorities is the very first prerequisite for the tarbiyah of our kids. Because once you will set the goal of your life, the perspective, the right priorities, wallahi, that's what you will transmit to your kids. So if we will mess up our priorities, our perspective, then we will not be able to transmit it in the right way. To understand the right perspective of the life and the right priorities, I'm going to share with you the story of Hazrat Amr bin Al-As. One time he came home and he saw his wife, the mother of the child, feeding the child, and he addressed to her, says that when you are feeding your child, don't feed the child like you're feeding, you know, your child. Rather, have the right perspective. Think this way, that you are helping one abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to become stronger, so that tomorrow this child will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will do abudiyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will do sujood in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So have that perspective in life, that you are helping one abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get stronger, so that he can do service to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whatever he will do in his life will become sadqa-e jariya for you. Hazrat Maulana Muhammad Ali Johar's mother says And you know Maulana Muhammad Ali Johar, one of the scholar of India, and he is buried, you know, look at his maqam, that he is buried in Masjid Al-Aqsa now. And I have visited his grave, that Allah gave him such a status. The mother of Maulana Muhammad Ali Johar says that I never fed my child without wudu. Even if I had to wake up 2 o'clock in the morning to feed my child, I have always made wudu first and then I had fed him. Having this right perspective, my brothers, that you are here for a reason. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That you are here as a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you have started this family, choosing the right spouse, and your focus was only one, and your perspective was that you are going to raise family, and the goal of this family will be to serve the purpose of life, to become role model for community. Their focus will be to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to make this family coolness of your eyes. You want to make them exemplary for not only just for their family, but for community, for humanity. And when your family will walk through the life of this dunya, they will become your legacy. They will become your Jannah of this dunya. They will become reason of Jannah for you in the life hereafter, my brothers and my sisters. The second thing which I will say here, before I will go and give you a few tips about tarbiyah, what is tarbiyah? Tarbiyah is to teach our family how to make right choices in life. They will always face two options to how to pick the right one, the right choice, to teach them what is right and what is wrong. So making them smart about their choices, making them smart to make the right choices in life, and teaching them what is right and what is wrong, this is what all about tarbiyah is, my brothers and my sisters. And you know, our job is, our role is to facilitate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already put 3 qualities in every child: character, confidence, and creativity. Every child is born with these 3 qualities. Our job is to facilitate, to nurture these qualities further, my brothers and my sisters. And we know the limitation of our education system. Our education system, as Einstein has said very rightly, it expects from a fish to crawl on a tree. There is a limitation of our education system. So we have to facilitate, we should be the facilitator for our kids' tarbiyah, to make sure we equip them, we teach them, we make them learn things which are needed for them to be successful in the society, my brothers and my sisters. And for that, the condition is that we should have ta'alluq, relationship, unconditional love. We should not be the one directing them to choose this and not to choose that. Rather, we should be the one with our unconditional love. We are the facilitator. We are teaching them how to fish. My brothers and my sisters, if our kids will have a bigger picture of life in front of them, and we will set the right priorities and perspective of life, then we will facilitate through our ta'alluq, through our sincere love with them, and we will help them to walk through the journey of this life, my brothers and my sisters. There is one more point I want to make here, when we are the facilitators for them during this Tarbiyah course, make sure that we have a good communication with our kids. You know, the only way we really can influence the life of our kids, the only way that we can make difference in their life is through bonding, through connection, through unconditional love. And when you will have that bonding, then you will see the communication channel will always be open between two of you. When we force things on them, and when we want them to follow my wishes, what I want you to be, and when we turn them away from their real potential, that is the time when this door of communication gets shut, my brothers and my sisters. So this is very important, that we should always make sure that we have this communication channel stay open between us and our family, our kids. The very first principle I will go through after I have given you some prerequisites for the tarbiyah is that we ourselves should become a role model for them. You know, as it is very rightly said, that our children, they listen through their eyes, not through their ears. They listen through their eyes. So they will do what they will see us doing. We are their role model. They have very high status for you and me in their life. So we are their motivational force. So we have to make sure that whatever priorities I will have of life, whatever perspective I will have of life, my kids are going to adopt the same role model, even if I don't teach them. Whatever I will believe in, this will get transmitted to my kids without even me uttering a single word. If they see me in my life, that what is the priority of life, if they see me, that focus of my life is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they see me, that my focus is, yes, we have to take our portion of this dunya, but our focus is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this will be transmitted to them without me even saying a single word. We have to understand this. Whatever we believe in, it gets transmitted to our kids. And let me tell you one more thing here, that wallahi, with my own experience, I have seen, you know, my experience as a family doctor, as a family counselor, and I travel, you know, all around the world, and what I have witnessed in our Muslim families, that if your focus of life is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you put that in the heart of your kids as well, in the mind of your kids as well, that the focus of our life should be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you connect your family with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you make Allah priority of your life, wallahi, your children will stay yours. Otherwise, I have seen, once they are grown up, they turn their back on their parents. But if you teach them the real true connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if they will go away from you for a short period of time, they will come back. I have never seen a single family that if they had right perspective of life and they have put this in the mind and heart of their kids, that our focus is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have ever lost their kids. They always come back, even if they go away for some short period of time. My brothers and my sisters. Another thing which I will suggest here for tarbiyah is exposure. Increase their exposure, my brothers and my sisters. And for exposure, I will have many layers. The first thing is, let them have exposure of the nature. When you travel, when you journey, not only you learn, your family learns. So if you can afford to travel, local travel, international travel, traveling always widens the horizon of you and your family. It always gives you experience that they have more exposure to learn new things. The exposure of your extended family. You know, a lot of time, you know, this is one of the drawbacks living in West, is that we all are becoming more self-centered. We only care about ourselves or maximum maybe our immediate family. And wallahi, always invest in your family and your extended family. And end of the day, the people who will stand with you will be your family. That's why, you know, it is said, there is a saying in Japanese, that when you are going uphill to climax, that you are going towards the peak of your life, then always say hello, hi to people you see on your way of climax, your way, your journey of peak, your journey of success. Because if you will fall down, and these people that who you have connection with, these are the people, they are going to help you when you fall. My brothers and my sisters, this is very important to expose our kids to our extended. This is very much needed for them, for their future relationships, for the marriages, for their future journey. So don't isolate them. Even if you live in a, it's so easy these days to communicate, making phone calls and making sure that you make them stay connected. I heard one very beautiful phrase from one of the brother that he was giving one talk on the TV. You know, when I call my grandfather, I just tell him one sentence. Grandpa, for me, the most loving thing is to listen to your voice. Just listening to your voice brings peace in my heart. So even if we don't talk anything, I don't say anything, but whenever I see your face and I listen to your voice, it works like a tranquilizer for me, brings peace for me. That kind of connection with our parents, with our extended family is very much needed, my brothers and my sisters. So let them get exposed to our extended family. There is another exposure I want our kids to learn, and that is they should learn the social skills. You know, the drawback of our education system is it makes them, you know, a good student. It makes them, you know, slave of grades and career, very tunnel vision of things. And it does not teach them anything what practically they need in life. Academics, yes, the education system can teach them to some extent. But wallahi, in practical life, they just don't need education or degree or number. And here I will say one more thing. Don't make your kids slave of these grades and career and numbers. Give them a bigger, this is needed. Yes, good to have to be doctor, it's good to be engineer, it's good to be computer scientist. But that is not really the only goal of your life. Your life has more meaning, more purpose than just a piece of paper of your diploma or just your career or just your life. My brothers and my sisters, so we have to teach our kids skills they don't learn through the education system. Most of the time what we do when our kids come back from school, we continue forcing the same what they have learned in school. Memorize this, memorize that, go for tuition. Same stuff what he has learned. Give them some break. Teach them how to talk to people. When your guests come, let them sit with your guests. Let them serve your guest. Even if you have help at home, don't ask your help to serve your guest. Let them learn how to serve them, how to take care of the guest. Teach them if there is a conflict, how to resolve it, how to give a speech, how to communicate with people. These skills are very much needed today, my brothers and my sisters. Especially in this time and age we live in, our kids are losing these skills. So their exposure to social skills, you know, yes, they need, you know, intellect skills, they need emotional skills, they need social skills. But the social skills is something which is very much needed. That's why we are seeing more family issues down the road in our families, because our kids, they are very good in, you know, academics, they are have good grades, they are doctor, they are engineer, but they don't know how to live a normal life in home, how to talk to people, how to address people in a proper way, how to sit and handle, you know, single person or crowd of people. These skills we have to teach to our kids, my brothers and my sisters. You know, the biggest obstacle in the tarbiyah of our kids is we ourselves. And as it is said very rightly, the biggest obstacle in the tarbiyah, in the growth, in journey to success of our family, our kids, is we, because of our temperament, our money, our wrong perspective and priorities. These are the three main obstacles. Our temperament, our money, our wrong perspective and priorities of life. My brothers and my sisters, so we have to watch, you know, ourselves when we are doing tarbiyah of, you know, having knowledge is not just enough, but providing them the right environment to learn. Another point I want to make here in tarbiyah of our kids is to respect your kids. One of the psychologists, he has written a book that if you treat your children like adults, if you treat your child like you treat the most respected person in your life, if you treat the child, the goal, the journey, ultimate goal, you want him to be seen. If you treat your child with respect, with dignity, waqar, ikram, you know, you give them the respect you give to the most respected in your community, you will see a different confidence, a different growth in your child, my brothers and my sisters. Never talk about the deficiencies, you know, of your child, shortcomings of your child, weaknesses of your child in front of anybody. Always give them privacy. Children do not like to be humiliated in front of people. A lot of parents I have seen, they do mistake even in front of their other siblings. If you want to address an issue with your child, always have some private movement with that child, and always have a positive perspective. Wallahi, when we go negative, when we lose trust in our child, when we doubt their intention, it basically, you know, shatters their confidence. It shatters their personality. So our discussion should have respect, privacy. We should give them space. We should always trust them. We should always have a positive perspective when we are talking to them. We never should doubt the intention of the child. So if you sit down and talk to your child and give them the confidence, and in a very comfortable environment you talk, that talk will have a totally different outcome. Forcing things, doubting intention, you know, making them feel, you know, putting them down or belittling them or pointing out, you know, their weaknesses and their deficiencies again and again in a negative way, it shatters their confidence, their creativity, and their character, my brothers and my sisters. So I will suggest here that we should always respect our kids. You know what happens? There are three things if you realize in our children's life. When they are very young, three things we have seen: the nearness, the knowledge about your child, and love to your child. These three things are at its peak. That we are very close to them, we know exactly what's going on in their life, and we have unconditional love with them. But as they grow, if you pay attention, all these three connections, they get weak. They should be more stronger because they need these three things the most now as compared to when they were little. They need our nearness, closeness. They need us to know more about them than anybody else. And they want love from us instead of having love from outside. If we lose this nearness with our kids, and if we do not know what's going on in their life, and if they feel like even our love is with conditions, that if you have this degree, or if you memorize this, or if you have, you know, this diploma, then I will love you, otherwise not, then these three connections, they get weaker and weaker and weaker. And that's why we see a generation gap. That's why we see distance between us and our kids. So I will say it again, that please provide your child unconditional love. Have positive perspective. Always have mindset of forward looking. Even if they do mistake, we all have done mistakes. Nobody is immune from mistakes. But the one who failed, the one who has done mistake, the one who has wronged himself, he is the one he need most of your support. You know, I remember I saw one clip in India. There was a Sikh father who had done a very huge party celebration of his son when the result of his matriculation exam came. And the father knew that he has failed. And wallahi, when this child came to home and he saw this celebration, he thought maybe my father got the wrong information that I have passed, but I failed, and he was scared. And this father basically invited so many hundreds of people. And at the end, he goes on stage, the father, his son on his side, the one who has just failed the exam, and he holds his hand and he says, you know, this party is for his future success. I don't care if he has failed this exam. I love him regardless, and my love is unconditional for my son, and I see future success in his life. So that's why I love him, and that's why I have done this part. Look at the spirit. Look at how much confidence that party would have given to this son. How much strength. Failing is not an issue. Issue is once you fail, if you do not get up and walk again. And that's what the father did to him. My brothers, to always, you know, respect your child. Don't put them down. Don't make them feel, you know, down. Rather, give them, you know, encouragement, give them support, give them help. You know, another point I want to make when we are doing tarbiyah of our kids is that always there are certain stages of their life that we have to be very careful. Up to 7 years of age, this is a recording phase of their life. This is the phase when they are absorbing everything, just going in their memory, whatever they are seeing, whatever they are observing, whatever they are watching, up to 7 years. From 7 to 14 years, this is a processing time. They process all the information they have received. They analyze all the data they have in their memory, in their disk. And from 14, 15 onward, it's a play time. A lot of time we miss the opportunity of this window of up to 7 years of age. And we feel like it's just a child. You know, I was just reading a lot of child psychology in last few months, and I have, because I'm a pediatrician, baby doctor as well, so I see kids, and I have learned through my experience of 35 years as a pediatrician as well, that this age up to 7 years is the most important age of a child, that where we should set, you know, the priorities, we should give them the confidence. We should let them bring their potential out, help them, we facilitate to let their potential grow. We help them to create their self-awareness, the khudi. We help them to become what they want to become in future. This 7 year is the basic, fundamental, most important part of their life where you set the foundation for their future journey, my brothers and my sisters. So we really need to invest in this time. And you know, when I was talking about child psychology, really, if you want to learn the true behaviors that we all should have in our life, we should learn from kids. Their confidence. They are carefree. They do what they feel it is right, and they don't care what right or left person will feel about it. This confidence on themselves, that whatever they have felt is right, they do it. And they are sincere in their love. My brothers and my sisters, and they are honest, they are transparent. These are the qualities, and they are creative. From very beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put these qualities, you know, of creativity, the character and confidence in them. Our job is to nurture it further. They are like a seed. Our kids are like a seed. And seed has all the potential of the biggest tree possible. But as a farmer, if we provide the right environment to the seed will show all of its potential one day, inshallah. If we will not be able to provide the right environment to this child, that's why, you know, Quran says the father is like a sun and the mother is like a moon, and this child needs both the sun and the moon, so this seed can grow and show all of its potentials, my brothers and my sisters. So 7 years, up to 7, recording time, 7 to 14, analysis time, and the child analyzes everything in data. And after 14, 15, it's a play time. Wallahi, it's very difficult to change things after 14, 15. There is only 10% of our brain, the conscious brain, that which can still give us some opportunity window to change some of the habits of the kids. But 90% of their personality is already established by that age. So this is very important that we invest in first 7 years of the life of our child so that we can get a better outcome down the road, my brothers and my sisters. And that's why, you know, I always give this example that when you give confidence to your child, whatever you put in the mind and qualities of your child, that's what you see down the road. You know, I always give this example of elephant. When elephant gives birth to a child, do you know how that child gets trained? During the daytime, they allow this child, the elephant baby, to go and eat free. But at night, when this baby comes back, they tie the leg of that baby with coconut rope, very strong rope. And this child will be restless for a few days and will try to break the rope, but he cannot break the rope. One day, elephant baby will try, next day, 1 week, 2 weeks, and after that, it's every night. During the daytime, the baby, elephant baby, is free to go and walk around and eat, but nighttime, same exercise, tie the leg with this coconut rope. After 1 month, the baby elephant realizes that this is something that I cannot break. It's out of my, you know, control. I cannot break. This is out of my control. I cannot break this rope. This is programmed in the brain of that baby elephant. That's why when this elephant is a grown-up elephant, you might have seen in a zoo that they just put a little tiny rope in the leg of that elephant, and elephant will not even try to break, even though now this elephant has a power not only to break this rope, elephant can break the wall. But because this is already programmed in the brain of this elephant that you cannot break it, he will not even try. That's what we do most of the time with our kids, my brothers and my sisters. We should give them confidence, which is naturally given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should nurture it further. We should always, you know, widen their horizon. We should always give them the bigger picture of life. We should always teach them to live not just for themselves, but for everybody around them. To become a role model for not only just for the family, for humanity at large as well, my brothers and my sisters. And with the last thing, and I will close, that if we really want, a lot of time I have seen parents, they are concerned, worried about their kids, that if something happens to them, who will take care of their kids? And they try to accumulate this wealth and bank balances and properties and all that. Wallahi, I can tell you one thing with my experience. The only thing which will help your child is your tarbiyah. The only thing which will help your child is the right focus. The only thing which will help your child, your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we all know the story of Hazrat Khidr alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam. And in that story, when Khidr alayhi salam goes and built the wall of an orphan, the message is that if your focus is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you and your child is connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah can send Khidr like somebody today, even today, who can act like a Khidr for your child in this dunya to help them out. My brothers, if you have lived a life that you are supportive of the community, that your image is that you are a righteous person, you are a caring person, you have empathy with the people, you are an honest person, then wallahi, the community, the ummah, the people around you will never let your child go without help, without support. And I will also say one thing, watch your risk. Because your risk is also very important in tarbiyah of your child. I always give this example of Allama Iqbal, rahmatullah alayh, that his mother, she says that at one point she had some doubt about the earning of the father of Allama Iqbal. And she said that I bought goat with my own money, so that I will feed the milk of that goat to my child, not the money from my husband. And if you look at the life of Imam Bukhari, rahmatullah alayh, Imam Bukhari, the barakah Allah had given in his work, one of the thing was that when his father was dying, he was on deathbed, and somebody asked him that, do you want to say anything about your past life? He says, the one thing I want to say, that whatever I have earned in my life, I cannot even see a single penny coming in my account of any doubt. Not a single penny of doubt, let alone haram. Not even of doubt, my brothers. And that risk had given so much barakah in the life of Imam Bukhari, that there might be people who have done hadith work more than Imam Bukhari. But what status Allah had given to Imam Bukhari's work is because of the sincerity and the risk halal of his father. My brothers and my sisters, always remember your kids in your du'as. Always remember in your du'as. A lot of time, you know, we do everything, but we forget to make du'a for our children. In your special du'as, always keep them in your du'as. So when we will depart from this dunya, we can go with peace, we can go with confidence that the legacy I'm leaving behind, I have done my best. I did what I am supposed to do to raise my family, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His tawfiq, will give them strength and will make them sadaqah jariyah for me. My brothers and my sisters, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us this tawfiq, that we keep right focus of our life, and you know, the most valuable treasure of our life, our family. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us this tawfiq, that we can protect this treasure and we can bring barakah, the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this treasure through our sincerity, through our connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through our focus of pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana anilhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.